Alright guys, welcome to Ezekiel 5, and we're going to get right into it. It is still a continuation of the previous chapter, so let's run over there, and let's read the last couple of verses here. Verse 15, then he said to me, "See, I am giving you cow dung instead of human waste, and you shall prepare your bread over it. Moreover, he said to me, Son of man, surely I will cut off the supply of bread in Jerusalem. They shall eat bread by weight, and with anxiety, and shall drink water by measure, and with dread, that they may lack bread and water, and be dismayed with one another, and waste away because of their iniquity." So what he was doing in chapter 4, he was basically, all of chapter 4 was dipping into the seals in Revelation 6. Now let's go see what Ezekiel 5 has to say. A sword against Jerusalem. "And you, son of man, take a sharp sword, take it as a barber's razor, and pass it over your head and your beard. Then take scales to weigh and divide the hair." Now back then, this was a big thing. You didn't shave. You didn't make your head shorn. You didn't shave your beard off. Your beard was one of the things that made you who you were. It was very important that you grew a big beard. It was very important that you had your hair a certain way, that you didn't shave it off. So he would look very funny in a group of very hairy men. Verse 2, "You shall burn with fire one-third in the midst of the city when the days of the siege are finished. Then you shall take one-third and strike around it with a sword, and one-third you shall scatter in the wind." So what is he doing here? This is an example. This is a sign. And they understand what he's doing. A third will be burned, a third will be hit with a sword, and a third will be scattered around the world. That's to the people. "I will draw out a sword after them." Verse 3, "You shall also take a small number of them and bind them in the edge of your garment." So he's going to tie some of the hairs in there. This, and the Jews watching this understand what he's doing. It makes sense to them. Verse 4, "Then take some of them again and throw them into the midst of the fire and burn them in the fire." What would that be? "From there a fire will go out into all the house of Israel." What would that be? Would that be hell? Maybe. Verse 5, "Thus says the Lord God, this is Jerusalem. I have set her in the midst of the nations and the countries all around her. She has rebelled against my judgments by doing wickedness more than the nations." Key verses here, if you're remembering and looking for more stuff about Mystery Babylon, this is a good area to pay attention to. "She has rebelled against my judgments by doing wickedness more than the nations, and against my statutes more than the countries that are all around her. For they have refused my judgments, and they have not walked in my statutes. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you have multiplied disobedience more than the nations that are all around you, have not walked in my statutes, nor kept my judgments, nor even done according to the judgments of the nations that are all around you. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, indeed I am against you and will execute judgments in your midst in the sight of the nations." That's the tribulation. Verse 9, "And I will do among you what I have never done." Hello, the worst time the world has ever seen. "And the like of which I will never do again because of all your abominations." The tribulation, the great tribulation, that second 3.5 years is the great tribulation. Specifically referred to in the Bible. The first 3.5 is the beginning part of it, which leads up to that second half. And the second half is horrible beyond measure. It says that will be the worst time the earth has ever seen or ever will see. Now, the whole thing, the whole 7 years is going to be that time. But that second half, that's the worst possible time there is. And that's when the worst persecution is going to come upon Israel. And he just proved it and validated it right here. Verse 9, "And I will do among you what I've never done, and the like of which I will never do again because of all your abominations." So clearly this is connecting directly to Revelation. "Therefore, the fathers shall eat their sons in your midst. And the sons shall eat their fathers, and I will execute judgments among you, and all of you who remain I will scatter to all the winds." Now, where else did we see that? Because I believe Isaiah mentioned that, and mentioned this particular thing happening. That was mentioned in verse 10 about cannibalism. Now, there's another way to look at that, too, about eating them. It's about destroying them. Fathers will give their sons over to the jailers and stuff like that because they're going to side with the government. Sons are going to do the same thing. Jesus also mentions, I will bring a sword to separate families. Father against son, son against father, mother, daughter, mother-in-law, all that stuff. So there's two ways to actually look at that particular verse. Verse 11, therefore, as I live, says the Lord God, surely because you have defiled my sanctuary with all your detestable things, with all your abominations, therefore, I will also diminish you. My eye will not spare, nor will I have any pity. One third of you shall die of the pestilence and be consumed with famine in your midst, and one third shall fall by the sword all around you, and I will scatter another third to all the winds, and I will draw out a sword after them. That you can go right to Revelation chapter 6 and read the horsemen and what they're going to do across the whole earth. Same thing. Verse 13, thus shall my anger be spent, and I will cause my fury to rest upon them, and I will be avenged, and they shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it in my zeal when I have spent my fury upon them, when he pours his cup of wrath out full strength. Verse 14, moreover, I will make you a waste and a reproach among the nations that are all around you, in the sight of all who pass by. So it shall be a reproach, a taunt, a lesson, and an astonishment to the nations that are all around you, when I execute judgments among you in anger and in fury and in furious rebukes, I, the Lord, have spoken. What does that sound like to you? When the ships that did business with her are far off, lament her and mourn her, seeing her fire rise up, her smoke of her torment and her judgment rise up. When it talks about who? Mystery Babylon? Yeah. All the nations will be looking to see it. Yeah. This is why I said this is, if you're looking for more stuff relating to Mystery Babylon, this is one of the ones you can do a study in Ezekiel 5. It leads to that. I'm not happy that I see this in there, but it's there, so. Verse 16, when I send against them the terrible arrows of famine, which shall be for destruction, which I will send to destroy you, I will increase the famine upon you and cut off your supply of bread. So I will send against you famine and wild beasts, that's also in the seals, and they will bereave you. Pestilence and blood shall pass through you, and I will bring the sword against you. I, the Lord, have spoken. It all connects. See, Ezekiel, like I said yesterday, in Ezekiel 5, it's going to get into some heavy stuff. This is heavy stuff. And this is specific stuff. He is pushing hard against Israel. Here's what's going to happen to you. And it's going to happen. I've spoken it. It will happen. It's a promise. And we can go into the seals and see this in the seals quite specifically. And he's so heavily referencing the book of Revelation, it's unbelievable. But it's more proof. It's more validation to the book. Incredible stuff. And there's a lot of connections here, a lot of implications here about what's going to happen during the time that this earth has never seen or has ever seen or ever will see. Judgment like no one has ever believed. It's going to be tidal waves every hour, volcanoes erupting around the whole earth, 100-pound hailstones falling and killing people, earthquakes almost nonstop. The earth is going to flip on its axis. The sky is going to roll back. The stars are going to fall. It's going to be just shocking to see the terrible things, armies marching everywhere, people burning and dying everywhere, killing each other everywhere. Animals running around, losing their mind, killing people. It'll be utter and mass chaos. It'll be hell on earth. And there are people that want to see if they can survive that. How much pride does a person have to think that they could survive that? It is only by God's will anybody survives. Terrible. But here we have more confirmation of this time frame. Here in Ezekiel 5. Ezekiel 6, tomorrow will be judgment on idolatrous Israel. More judgment. Continuation too, I believe. Yep. No, not a continuation. This is a new thought. So we're getting into a new thought now. So I can just imagine what Ezekiel's going through here. But he's so enamored with the Lord and what the Lord is doing. He's like, I'm just going to tell this story, and whatever happens, happens. And I don't remember exactly what they did to Ezekiel after this, but I imagine they put him to death. Guys, that was Ezekiel 5. Pretty harsh, but it must happen. These things have to happen because look at the world. The world is literally giving God the finger with the way they're doing things. They're literally spitting in his face. They could care less what God thinks. And it's a competition to see how bad they can get. And funny enough, he says in his word, that's what they were going to do. Mock and scoff. Carrying around signs saying, bring Jesus back, we'll kill him again. And they're laughing. Laugh now. There's a day coming when all these things that we've been warning you all about is going to come true. And then you're going to be standing here looking at it. And you're going to go, might have made a mistake. The Lord will bring justice. He will bring truth, and the world cannot stop it. If Jesus came back again now, they're not killing anybody. Because when he comes back, he's coming back with a sword. They would much rather die in the beginning of the tribulation than live to the end and have to stand there and watch him approach. Because the amount of terror is going to be in the hearts, the amount of terror described in the Bible, in the hearts of the people when they see him coming for his second time, and a whole army of people coming behind him. Some of those people they may recognize as people that they knew that died or were raptured. And the first thing he does when he touches the ground is head to Edom and comes back covered in their blood. Because of judgment. This is all recorded in the Bible. Should be no surprise. And it has to happen. Our God has set aside that time frame for that purpose. It has to happen. Because the world will not change. This is why I'm adamant about you guys reading the Word. Stay in the Word. Dedicate some time every day. Take time away from something else that's less important. And dedicate some time every day to reading the Bible. I'm helping you guys out by putting it on the screen here and sharing it with you, but it's different when you read it yourself. It has more of an impact. You're feeding on that word. And the Lord will show you the same or even better things than what I'm showing you or what he showed me. And it will open your eyes and make this more real than you can possibly imagine. And the day is coming when we will see all of it fulfilled in living color. Well, we won't see it because we're not going to be here. We're going to be involved in something else, much more focused on the Lord and heaven than here. This is going to be dealt with on its own. I'm looking forward to that day because what I've learned about that time frame, I don't want to see it. I don't want to be here for that. I don't want to watch it happen. I don't want to see it from heaven. I just want to go stand with the Lord and learn from him and see what he's got to offer. See what he's doing. See what he has planned. That was Ezekiel 5, guys. Thank you all for watching. See you on the next one.